have Anne Corbett in our midst, a researcher and author since many years, born in London, now living in Paris, and a senior associate of the LSE Consulting, London School of Economics. Anne, thank you for joining us. You told me that you are preparing a book. Is it allowed to ask already what it will be about?
Well, of course it is. I mean, it's a book which has been inspired by Brexit as the sort of conjunctural factor. But actually, I've been sort of working on European higher education for a long time. And so the book is about what does the Brexit shock represent for universities in Britain and Europe? And then I look at it in some sort of historical depths as well to see, in fact, which is, after all, I think of it, I would like to claim that it's a good academic way of looking at it, because out of every shock comes opportunities as well as restraints.
I'm wondering, industry and intellectual movement across the borders is now more the rule than the exception, and part of this productive forces are the universities. Do you think that the people who made Brexit happen are not aware of this new times?
Well, I think they've got a different, I think there's a different view. You know, this has been driven by a government which is ideologically extraordinarily united, which perhaps represents, I've just seen a poll on this, 13% of the population who still believe very strongly in Brexit. You know, we've now got people accepting Brexit has been done and therefore thinking more in conventional party terms. But this government is absolutely driven by the idea that Britain's role is global. So I think that's their mentality. I don't suppose any of them are bilingual, but I don't know how many of them, I may be misjudging them, but they don't have a European culture. And that you've seen reflected in British policy for years. I mean, and even back to the time of Tony Blair, who was a European, but he never really exploited the opportunity to educate the British public about Europe. And after that, as cynicism has grown, I think a lot of misrepresentation. As somebody interested in education, I think it's a tragedy that British leaders, ever since joining the EU, have never really taken the time to educate. I mean, even in schools, I don't think it's a subject. They've never taken the time to explain to people at large the benefits of Europe. And then when you get economic stress and it's allied with immigration, particularly from other parts, from poorer parts of Europe, and then there's a reaction against that. And now you see what's happening. It's not peculiar to Britain, but that's the form it's taken in Britain.
But is it all bad? Being in the EU got this evergreen pinky shine on it. Aren't there national structures rolled over by the European harmonization that are worth saving, in your opinion?
Well, personally, no. I think that, again, what the Brexit vote showed was that people were absolutely fed up they kicked the government. Brexit was extraordinary because it allowed one person, one vote, instead of a system that we actually have where a lot of votes don't count because it's this majoritarian system. But the things that people complained about was the economy, deindustrialization, not having jobs that take the place of the old industries, the increasing gap between rich and poor. None of that comes from Europe. That is the outcome of political choices within the national government. Mm-hmm. So, but what I think is particular to Britain. We seem to be getting far from universities, but you know, we have to look at the structures. You know, Britain's parliamentary sovereignty, Britain's constitution being unwritten, it's all quite slippery. It gives governments, we're seeing it with the present government, the right to do things which in a more, in a country with a legal written constitution would be more difficult to do. And so I think this is all part of a general fog about what Europe's about and what the national government is about. Does that answer the question?
Yes.
Thank you again, Ann. Well, since January, we have the TCA, the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement, where also science and higher education have their share. How do you judge the results of this agreement for universities?
Well, can I take that in two parts? And the first is what the legal agreement with the EU is. And it's not just the TCA, which is the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. It's also the Withdrawal Act. And the Withdrawal Act was actually taking Britain out of the core EU legislation, the four freedoms. And so for universities, for higher education, for really a very large bit of the British population, the core thing was losing freedom of movement. This has been the freedom to work, to study anywhere within the EU. And it was disguised a bit because we had a transition period and it only came into effect on January the 1st this year. But I would say the core thing is that losing that freedom of movement and therefore the choice of things. And it affects professional recognition as well. Then the secondly is the TCA, which was the political agreement, which is largely focused on trade. But as you rightly say, it affects science and education because it affects the programmes of the EU. In law, Britain had every opportunity to join in these programmes because the EU opens them to non-EU members. In the case of Horizon, the science programme, they've accepted that with enthusiasm. Britain, of course, has had a very successful record in Horizon, able to lead a lot of projects. But they also chose, as you know, not to participate in Erasmus. And Erasmus is tragic. It's much valued by universities in Britain and by further education colleges because and also by academics and staff who can use it for who have benefited from things like the Jean Monnet programme. But the British government's always had a very narrow view of Erasmus, and what the way it judges Erasmus is that a lot more students come into Britain than go out through Erasmus. And so it sees it as losing money. It's never understood the breadth of Erasmus. It's never understood about reciprocity, but that's the judgment it's made. And it's produced its alternative, which we can talk about, but is nothing like Erasmus. Mm. So I personally think it's a tragedy, but it's happened. And it won't be changed in anything like the near future.
I heard British university leaders who take it quite from the bright side, like Peter Matheson, principal of the University of Edinburgh. He said, well, let's look forward to the next negotiations after 2027. He was quite positive, I had the impression. What is the opinion at British universities off record about Brexit? Is it more positive?
But no. In the short term, universities were devastated by Brexit. There were There were a few which made long-term plans from the beginning, like Imperial College, you know, the great science university, which now has a structural link with Munich so that it sort of can be considered European. I think the University of Kent has structural links in a base in Brussels. Some have tried rather imaginative things. University College London has asked, it was a very good move, I think. It asked its academics how it thought the university could thrive after leaving the EU. And the academics came up with the idea that, or the university between them, that there could be very strong links between towns rather than between countries. And so they've developed very, very distinct and strong disciplinary links with particular universities in Rome, in Paris, and in other cities. But others are struggling. They're struggling with whether they will get enough students, international students. They're struggling with whether they will get enough EU students. They want to lose EU students who'll be put off by the fees, you know, because that changes the culture of a classroom.
All right, next question. I read an interesting interview in Newsweek with Sir Ed Byrne, the former president of King's College. He said he was very proud of robust partnerships abroad, especially also in Europe. And he talks about the research-intensive universities working together in Europe. He said, "We have broad-ranging partnerships with the University of Paris and the University of Dresden. We formed a thing called Trans-Campus Deaneries. That's a faculty where the researchers and academics are jointly appointed and paid for by both universities." Do you feel the rise of European university alliances is signaling that the university is in a moment of change?
Well, I think you put your finger on something rather important there, because I think that what Byrne is describing, there have been all sorts of signs of universities, perhaps particularly elite universities and particularly the creative, the music and the arts colleges, theatre education, who've absolutely depended on cross-border contacts. And for example, law has been an area where universities have had partnerships across borders. I think that indeed we're in a situation where universities will be thinking more and more about that. Partly it's driven indeed by the needs of researchers who function across borders. And so I think that we will see more of that. In terms of what the European Universities Initiative will achieve, again, I think, you know, this is let a thousand flowers bloom. I think that that's a great thing too. And I personally felt quite elated watching some of your videos and seeing the reactions of seeing people who are on the job describing what they're doing. Yeah, I think that this is releasing an energy which, you know, is a product of our times, and in the British case, maybe spurred by Brexit.